The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
These are the sounds of crushed souls. The sounds of despair from former radio personalities, languishing in the purgatory of corporate consolidation. These former radio personalities have lost their livelihoods, not because they weren't entertaining or informative, but because they don't meet today's corporate terrestrial broadcast standards of being smelly, overweight douchebags, seething with vein-popping hatred. These radio refugees and their audiences have since migrated to the internet, but their struggle continues as the quest for monetization ensues. Nicole Sandler is leading the way to reestablishing thought-provoking and entertaining radio. And you can help by clicking the donate button on NicoleSandler.com. Donate today, or as much and as often as you can. Dry the tears of listeners by removing the rotting stench of corporate radio. Won't you help?
It's Empty Wheel Friday on the Nicole Sandler Show.
Oh, it is. And you know what that means. It's our weekly get-together with Marcy Wheeler of EmptyWheel.net. And, well, it's a big week. So, as you know, or you should know, we record these segments in the morning on Fridays, Arizona time, because Marcy's in Ireland. She is 6 hours ahead of us. So, just to make it work for both of us, we tape it in the morning, and I play it back in the afternoon. Just so you know, today Marcy was out of her home studio. Marcy is in, well, she'll tell us a little later. She's in another part of Ireland with her brother. So, you know, Wi-Fi in her hotel wasn't the best. But I think it's okay. So with no further ado, to the videotape we go. The day we thought might never come appears to be here on Monday. It is the Friday before the first real big criminal trial of a former president convenes in New York City. Marcy Wheeler, Donald Trump attempted to delay this time and time again, and he kept getting rebuffed, and now this morning he sent out this... I don't know if you saw a warning, like, all hell is going to break loose. Their scam trial is starting on Monday. Let's not stand for it. It sounds to me like he's trying to incite violence already.
Yeah, I mean, he's done it over and over again. If he does incite violence, let's see what the authorities say. But he's not going to enjoy it. He's not going to enjoy, like, you know, in his other, because it's actually, he's had two trials, right? So the Trump Organization has done a trial twice, plus the rape trial. So he's had a bunch of civil trials where he sat there and stewed in the courthouse. It's going to be a bit different as he's the criminal defendant here, but, you know, we'll see.
We'll see. So jury selection begins on Monday. Have you had a chance to look over? I know there were some, like the jury questionnaire has been released. Have you had a chance to check that out?
I haven't looked closely, but I've seen the kinds of questions they're asking. Are you QAnon, for example? I mean, jury selection, and people get paid a ton of money to do this. Like, jury selection is a way to find code to say, are you a Trump supporter? Because it's only going to take a Trump supporter to blow this case up.
Right. And you know, I guess we just have to wait and see. Now, the downside of this is there are no cameras in the courtroom. But there will be journalists in there who we have to trust. Do you have your sources of people who will be in the courtroom that you'll be following?
I don't know for sure who will be in there, but Adam Klossfeld is in New York, and he always does a tremendous job. He's now actually at Just Security because he got picked up after the Messenger debacle. He was like the best journalist at the Messenger. So he's going to, I expect, if he's covering it, I expect he'll do a great job. And Lisa Rubin, MSNBC, has really, I think, stepped up her ability to explain what the strategy that various lawyers are using. So I would follow those two people, especially.
Oh, cool.
Jose Pagliari from Daily Beast is also generally does pretty good coverage in New York trials.
Good. And there are others, but those are good starting points. And, of course, we'll pick up on Friday and see what happens. With any idea how long jury selection, the voir dire process is going to take?
I don't know, because in the two Trump Organization trials, it didn't take that long. So we'll see.
In the meantime, was it yesterday or the day before, Weisselberg, the CFO, went back to jail. He five more months at Rikers for perjury.
That means something you're all down.
Yeah. What blew my mind is someone said he's 2 years younger than Donald Trump. Wow. I didn't even realize that.
I don't wish Rikers on anybody.
No.
Like, I don't care who you are. Rikers is a terrible, horrible place. So, yeah. So he's in Rikers. The loyalty, right? One thing that I think Tish James is trying to do is say, well, if he pled guilty to perjury, then let's talk about why the documents that validated the point that we, the thing we used to prove his perjury, let's talk about why that was not turned over in criminal discovery. So we'll see. In response to a subpoena, I mean, Trump Organization has a little habit of not turning everything over, so we'll see.
So that's happening. And then just to put things in context, Monday is April 15th. 10 days later, Supreme Court will hear the case on Trump's contention that he has something he calls absolute immunity. This New York trial will be going on when the Supreme Court hears this case. So it's the first convergence.
There's actually two cases the Supreme Court will hear that week. The first one is from a guy named Fisher, a garden variety January 6th defendant named Fisher, who is challenging the way that DOJ used 18 U.S.C. 1512 1512 C2, and this is one of the crimes Donald Trump has been charged with. Probably, we don't actually. I don't have a terrific sense of why the Supreme Court accepted that challenge. They didn't grant a stay, so all these other garden variety January 6th trials are kind of stacking up now as we wait to see what they're going to do. But there are a couple of things that the Supreme Court is going to look at or may look at. One is, should you have used this obstruction charge with January 6th at all? Thus far, there's been no problem with it, but one reason I suspect that the Supreme Court may have taken this challenge is that Brett Kavanaugh, when these garden variety January 6th defendants challenge this statute, they always say, well, why weren't the protesters who stopped the Brett Kavanaugh confirmation hearings, why weren't they arrested like we were? There are several good reasons for that. One is that they went through security in the Capitol building. Like, either they trespassed in the Capitol building or SCOTUS, or they went through security. The people who actually shut down the hearing were people who went through security and were legally there, whereas the people on January 6th were not legally there because it was shut down during COVID. Right. So that's one thing. Another thing they may review is whether there needs to be a documentary component to the obstruction. So in other words, for all the other January 6ers who obstructed the vote certification by brawling with cops, they didn't fabricate a document, right? But for Trump, he did. For Trump, he did because of the fake vote certifications. So that's the second question. And the third question is how you get to corrupt purpose to be found guilty of that. You have to be, a jury has to say your effort to obstruct the vote certification was corrupt. Well, it's far easier to prove that with Trump because he's the one who would personally benefit from remaining president. But those are three things that the Supreme Court will review. I think it's the 22nd. So the 22nd, and then later in the week, they do the absolute immunity. So it's, 2 days of stuff that may actually impact Trump's criminal defense.
Right.
January 6th trial.
And the absolute immunity case that now will be heard on April 25th.
that is, they tack that on at the very end of the term. This will be the final case they hear in this term of the Supreme Court. Then they generally release their decisions or opinions or whatever they're officially called in June and sometimes into July. And the question is, will this be held till the very end as they help ostensibly Trump delay things? We don't know.
I have a suspicion, like, this is not my forte. People should listen to Steve Waddick. He's the best, I think, Supreme Court watcher on this stuff. But I have a suspicion that there may have been a bit of a deal with Colorado, the Colorado disqualification case, where the way in which they resolved that and got to unanimity on that one involved a trade-off that there would actually be a decision, an opinion released on this immunity thing. So I'm fairly optimistic we're going to see it by June 30th, and therefore I'm fairly optimistic that that trial will start, you know, jury selection will start in September. But we don't know because it's the Supreme Court and they're nuts.
Yes, they are. There is that. Marcy Wheeler is here, as she is every Friday. This was a big week for Empty Wheel. Looking at emptywheel.net, of course, one post stands out. It's from Tuesday of this week, and the headline is Empty Wheel Makes CIPA History. CIPA, of course, meaning the Classified Information Procedures Act. And
you're good, Nicole.
Thank you. I do my homework. And so you actually intervened in this case to oppose the government's bid to keep some transcripts sealed. Can you explain what this is about for those who aren't up on the story?
Sure. When somebody is charged with the Espionage Act, including Donald Trump, and that's why this could get interesting, there's a way in which you can avoid sharing the evidence such that it'll become public. And in the Josh Schulte case, Josh Schulte is the guy who was convicted of stealing CIA's hacking tools and sending them to WikiLeaks.
Okay.
So in his case, he challenged whether he could be charged with espionage, with additional counts of Espionage Act for trying to leak stuff from jail. So he was arrested in 2017. He was jailed at the end of 2017. It wasn't until June of 2018 that they charged him with the Espionage Act. Later in August of 2018, he was continuing to leak from jail. And so they charged him with attempting to leak on Twitter. And he said, well, can I really be charged with violating the Espionage Act if I'm sharing secrets that I already, that WikiLeaks already published on WikiLeaks, right? And the judge from the start has wanted to make the colloquy, the discussion they had about this at a particular hearing, public. Like he sort of said way back, Schulte was found guilty in 2022, September of 2022, the judge is like, tell me why I shouldn't release this classified hearing. Tell me, I want you to declassify it. I want you to do a classification review. And then I want you to argue why you shouldn't release it. And it was sort of like he wanted to rule this way anyway. And it was myself and Inner City News, who's an independent journalist outside of New York, and we both intervened. I intervened with a guy named Kel McClanahan from National Security Counselors, who generally represents people who've been accused of the Espionage Act. And he's, you know, he's a muckety muck and a professor somewhere in DC. Anyway, so I asked him if he would represent me, and we have to see. Either the government is going to have to declassify stuff and publish stuff they didn't want, or they're going to appeal it. And I wouldn't be surprised if they appealed it for two reasons, which I'll get to in a second. And if they appeal it, then poor Cal is going to have to, you know, see if he wants to fight it in the second circuit. Because this is like historic that you get to see one of these hearings. The language in question was sort of what I explained, like, under the First Amendment, if you republish something that was classified, but you're not cleared, so you don't necessarily know that it was classified, can you be charged with the Espionage Act? And this is directly relevant to Julian Assange, right? Mm-hmm. So Julian Assange, I think also Monday, the government has to give reassurances to the high court there that on two bases, one, that he's not going to be given the death penalty, which is going to be easy to do. And right. The other one is that he's going to have the same First Amendment rights that anybody else in the United States would have. That, you know, the UK is not going to extradite him unless he's going to be treated like an American citizen would have been.
Right.
And, but this CIPA hearing is directly on point to that. I think also on Monday, sometime next week, DOJ has to give the British High Court assurances on two points before the UK will extradite him. One is easy. Will he be subject to the death penalty? No, he won't be. They've already said any punishment that he is, you know, if he's found guilty, any punishment will be in Australia. The second one, though, is the First Amendment. The UK has said we're going to let him appeal if he would not get the same First Amendment rights that any other defendant in the United States will get. And for example, one question is, can he invoke the Pentagon Papers? Can he invoke prior restraint and say, you know, he should be able to publish just like the New York Times was able to publish? So those are the questions. And this CIPA colloquy that I just described probably is really closely on point. For example, the DOJ may have said something to this judge in the secret hearing specifically about whether Julian Assange could be charged with the Espionage Act under this. So that's the stuff. Like, I didn't know that. Cal McClanahan didn't know that. Like, I just knew that this was something that was going to be interesting and probably really important from a First Amendment standpoint. So we challenged, we'll see what DOJ does. They have until May 3rd, I think, to publish it. So they have a little, like, the way these timings go. But the other reason this is important, right? So Trump's espionage case in Florida. But
hold on. Can I, before we get to that, can I just ask, didn't we hear something this week that Joe Biden said they may drop the charges against Julian Assange? They may not prosecute him? Is that related?
I'm not sure that's reliable. Okay. Like, hold out on that. Okay. Now, let's see. We'll know more next week.
Gotcha.
If they decide to give those assurances. One of the things they could do next week, which I thought would be really clever on DOJ's part, is to say, we're only going to rely on him disseminating the information non-publicly. So, for example, we know for a fact that Julian Assange took the State Department cables, and before he published them, he gave a subset of them to this guy, Israel Shamir, who then gave them to Belarus. And Belarus had this advance notice on basically dissidents. We should, you know, there's good reason to believe that Israel Shamir also shared that with Russia. So wow. Julian Assange for a long time has had this habit of pre-sharing stuff with Russia. And that is obviously, there's not prior restraint for giving stuff to somebody who may be a Russian spy, like the New York Times. The New York Times doesn't do that as far as we know. So things will get interesting on the Julian Assange case for that yes. reason in the next week.
Okay, so we'll hold off on that. Okay, great. I just had to ask.
No, it's a good question. I'm a little bit skeptical that Joe Biden was, you know, I think he was just getting rid of a journalist.
Okay.
Gotcha. But the other reason this matters is because Trump's case has to go through CIPA as well, right? This is the stolen documents case that Aileen Cannon is trying to bollocks. And in that case, there will be a question. I mean, there will be this similar hearing. There will be a similar hearing where Trump gets to say, I want to see all of these documents declassified.
Right.
And if the judge, it's Jesse Furman in SDNY, if his ruling stands, then Trump is going to point to that ruling and say, well, Marcy Wheeler got these documents, so I should be able to get these documents. So that may make it'll be interesting.
Interesting is that's a given. It will all be interesting seeing how it plays out. But so this all goes back to this filing, that your intervention in the CIPA case relates to, obviously, the documents case, at the Mar A Lago case that Aileen Cannon, as you said, is trying to bollocks. You filed this intervention back in 2022. So it's just coming back now. This it should be big news, like bigger than that. Just reading about it at emptywheel.net. Not that that's a bad thing, but this is huge. This is a big deal, isn't it?
Well, it could be. I mean, let's see what happens. Like when I was doing this, this is a dirty secret. I often nod to the New York Times and I'll tell somebody at the New York Times, hey, you guys should go get this. Cause of course they have an entire legal department.
Yes, they do.
Great First Amendment lawyers. And in this case, I kept it in my pocket because I didn't have great confidence that the New York Times would go after this the same way. Me and Inner City News were the only two outlets that covered this closely. And so that's part of the concern is that this was a huge leak and there was a hung jury the first time it was tried. And it's the equivalent of Hansen not being prosecuted, not being convicted. And so I think that the whole Josh Schulte case is much bigger. It sort of pissed me off. I wanted somebody else to cover it and I was stuck covering it. But so I think that because people weren't covering the trial closely, the usual suspects who would have challenged this, there's a media consortium where the New York Times often does, they didn't. And so it was like, it has to be done. I don't think they understand the case well enough. So I asked McClanahan and he said yes. So now it's me, right?
Wow.
I'm happy to be a jeer though, Nicole, because remember I got those warrants unsealed in the Hunter Biden case. So
yes. Well, I was going to say, this is like Hunter Biden that you are covering because you have to, because nobody else is covering it the way you are. So your piece from Tuesday at emptywheel.net, the Empty Wheel Makes CIPA History, starts with your line, yesterday, Judge Aileen Cannon issued a surly order acceding to Jack Smith's request to protect witnesses. But she not only protect witnesses, what she hinted that she wants to do, and please correct me if I got this wrong, because I often do and I like to be corrected. I have something else I need to correct too. But the she wanted the jury to be able to see these documents that were classified, many top secret, that Donald Trump stole, in order for them to determine whether or not they were his personal documents. This all has bearing on that, yes or no?
Yeah, they'll get to see the documents, right? So CIPA, the Souter Libby and the Jeffrey Sterling case are the ones that you get best example of the document of how they get delivered to the jury, right? There'll be big parts that are redacted, or instead of Iran, it might say hostile power in the Middle East. They have to be shared with the jury. That's right. What this entire right. CIPA thing is about is how do you give Donald Trump a fair trial when he's accused of stealing, the most secret documents? So they will get some version of them. What Cannon was doing was slightly different. She was saying, not only does the jury have to see the documents, and the jury's job normally in an espionage case is to determine whether this is national defense information. So they're going to look at it and say, a document about the U.S. nuclear facilities, that's national defense. Nuclear bombs, national defense. How to attack Iran, national defense. So those are the kinds of decisions the jury would normally make. She is leaving open the possibility she would also ask the jury to find whether Trump had converted these to his public, to his personal, to be his own documents, basically.
Right, to declassify them, made them his own by taking them out of the White House, or by just thinking, which is something he's floated before, just in his mind deciding, I've declassified these, abracadabra, they're declassified. Isn't that
right,
something?
Right, this is a Tom Fitton theory. Yeah, no, you got the theory right. But the important thing is Trump didn't even learn this theory until 2022. So he had already stolen the documents. So it's going to be a lousy defense. But the concern about it is that Aileen Cannon is going to kind of bollocks the case after a jury has been seated. And it's a way to blow the trial for Donald Trump. It's basically a way to give him a win.
Right. And it, so the filing, Jack Smith has been filing all these things. Her response to him that you said was surly, understatement. That's how she's been responding to him, isn't it? I mean, there's been this a seemingly open animosity. We know she's in the tank for Trump. And is he just trying to hedge against how she could totally throw it? Once the jury is seated and the case begins, his hands are tied, aren't they?
Right. So no one really knows why Aileen Cannon is so surly. One explanation is, and a guy named David Latt did this based after like some of her clerks left. And his theory was she was an appellate lawyer at DOJ. And so she's having a tough time transitioning to be a district judge because she didn't, as a prosecutor, when she worked for DOJ, she didn't do the nuts and bolts of trial work. She instead wrote appellate filings, right? So that's a nice theory. Like she's still trying to figure out how to be a district judge. Possibly that's part of it. A bigger part of it is that she intervened with the search back in 2022, and she got like just smacked down by the 11th Circuit. And so one explanation is she's so bitter about that, she's looking for revenge. And then the third is that she's kind of in the tank for Donald Trump. And, you know, depending on what happens with the election, she has not scheduled the trial yet. My biggest concern about this case, honestly, is that she'll block Chutkin. So in other words, like she will schedule it on June 15th, just in advance of the Supreme Court issuing their ruling.
And on immunity, and Chutkin is the Georgia case, right?
No, Chutkin is the D.C. case.
Okay.
So
the January 6th.
January 6th case.
Got it.
And like I said, based on what we expect SCOTUS to do, we expect them to come up with a ruling on by June 30th, then the trial, the jury selection could start in September. And so Trump would basically spend most of the final election season in trial in D.C. And so I could see there are ways that Aileen Cannon could block that. And that is one of my biggest concerns, because I think that January 6th trial will be going during the election. Wow. And it's the case that the journalists understand better. And I did this last Friday. I talked about the really cool geofence stuff they're doing. Yes. I mean, there's going to be some pretty, pretty sexy trial arguments that I think will be interesting if they're delivered during the election season. So, I don't think Aileen Cannon is going to go to trial before the election. And then after the election, if Trump loses, then maybe she's not going to throw away her career based on trying to save Trump. If he wins, then, you know, of course she's going to do something crazy. So, yeah, we don't know.
We don't know. Now, speaking of Aileen Cannon, last week I cited a fake tweet, a truth, shit, whatever it is, that somebody in the comments at emptywheel.net said, it's not real. I'm only going to put it up for a second for reference. It certainly looks real. And this was retweeted by someone else who commented on it, in which, allegedly, this fake truther posing as Trump floated the idea, I'm going to make Aileen Cannon a Supreme Court justice, which I thought should have blown up is because conflict of interest. But I guess it was not. It sure looked real. Shame on me. So I'm correcting that. Thank you to the commenter at Empty Wheel who pointed it out. I'm not on Truth Social. And so it's hard to, I guess I should check before I cite something like that. Anyway, I'm able to correct it. So never mind, I guess. But, you know, the fact remains all the problems inherent with that case and the others. Now, the case that begins on Monday in New York, no cameras in the courtroom. You know, it's funny, not funny, haha, but curious that we saw that yesterday O.J. Simpson died. Good. I was remembering, I can't believe it was 30 years ago, but I lived through that. You know, I was living in Los Angeles at the time, and that, and it wasn't only LA, I was just in the thick of it, but that consumed everybody and everything because it was televised. You know, Watergate was televised. What are your thoughts on, should there be cameras in these courtrooms?
You know, I'd like to see there be cameras in the courtroom, but not for this trial, first and foremost,
okay. Right?
Because Donald Trump is such a serial witness tamperer. I think that, you know, if I'm forgetting the names of the, some of the cooperating witnesses, but when, if and when they testify, if they testified and their face was all over TV, that would, you know, magnify the, they're already going to get death threats. I promise you. And that's terrible. But because Trump's supporters are rabid nutballs. But if their faces are on TV, it's going to exacerbate it. And so I just don't think this should be the first trial that's televised for that reason.
Well, and it won't be. So there's that. Now, of all the ones that are coming up, we know the Supreme Court, no cameras, but we do get live audio. So we will be able to listen in real time, or they release the audio after the fact. It all changed during COVID. So I'm not sure if they do it live or release it like in the afternoon of the hearing. But either way.
We'll get the audio live.
Oh,
yeah.
Cool. Okay. Right. Well, I guess we'll find out. I know they used to do it where the audio would be released in the afternoon. Then during COVID, I think we got it live, but I don't know what it is now. So we'll find out before then. Again, that's 12 days away. It's all, you know, finally coming here. And then do we know about the other trials like Georgia and D.C., if those are allow cameras, or do we not know yet?
Georgia may, like all of the hearings, the hearing over whether Nate Wade had to be disqualified and Fonnie Willis, that was televised.
Right.
That was,
oh, that's right. Know, that was televised.
So that one maybe, but no, the federal trials will not be televised.
Okay. But there will be enough. I mean, we have a lot of people, you know, the low information voters out there who, you know, don't seem aware of all the legal problems he's got stacked against him because they get their so-called news from Fox or Newsmax or right-wing blogs that just don't report on the facts. So it's a weird media landscape out there where a lot of the people who are still firmly supporting him just aren't aware of what he's being charged with. Is that you think?
Yeah, I don't think they believe him. I mean, like, look, he's still calling the January 6th convicts,
hostages.
Right? Convicted January 6th people waiting their assignment, their BOP, their Bureau of Prisons assignment while in DC jail. He's still calling them hostages. These are people who, by and large, who assaulted cops.
That's
if
right.
If they're in DC jail, they assaulted cops or they did. You know, there's two or three who did something like a couple were fugitives, right? Another one is a guy, this is crazy, a guy named, if I'm remembering his first name correctly, it's Tyler Taranto, T-A-R-A-N-T-O. And this guy, mentally ill, has service-related PTSD. And Trump posted Barack Obama's address, his
right.
DC address
that.
On True Social, and this guy started stalking Barack Obama and was arrested because when they searched his van as he was stalking Barack Obama, he had explosives in there. So, you know, like that's one of the guys that Trump is calling a hostage. He was also at January 6th, which is why he's, you know, kind of, he's a twofer. But you know, I think, you know, Democrats are right now focused on making Trump own. Oh, now we can talk about Arizona, making Trump own the Dobbs, making Trump own. Here's your chance to talk about your new state. Now it's normally Florida we beat
oh
up on.
Oh, my God.
Arizona.
Yeah. It's, you know, gremlins follow me and troubles follow me. So I'm in Arizona where they just, this Arizona Supreme Court just said, okay, well, with Dobbs and Roe v. Wade being history, we're going to go back to not the law that was standing when Roe v. Wade came into effect, which I believe was a 15-week abortion ban. We're going to go back to an 1864 law that, before Arizona was even a state, before women had the vote, before any of this. And now we've learned that the guy who put this law on the books was a pedophile who, you know, married and impregnated girls as young as 12.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. It's horrible.
Yeah, that's some of the best reporting on it, because Arizona adopted this like super archaic law about like basically no abortion. And the source of that law is the most sleazy kind of man trying to regulate women. And so, the Democrats right now are trying to make Donald Trump own Dobbs, which, should be easy to do because judges were his. I think also I assume they're going to try and make him own his coddling of violent felons, because that's effectively what calling these people hostages is. And, he should own it because he should own January 6th. Oops.
Without a doubt. Sorry, I was trying to bring over the email today that he sent out. If I can, while we're talking, I'll try to find it. It's heinous, but that's what he does. He's trying to ratchet up. Look, we've had this conversation before, Marcy Wheeler, where you've said there's a non-zero chance that there will be political violence this year. And already he's trying to push it for Monday by, calling out the trial that's beginning and claiming it's, it's a sham and all hell's going to break loose. Well, all hell's going to break loose because he's telling you to break hell loose. One doesn't really happen without the other, I think. I got to ask my favorite. Oh, you want to say something on that?
Oh, regarding New York, Lisa Rubin had a stat the other day. She because Trump keeps appealing and keeps getting rejected. And Lisa Rubin, so MSNBC, said that of the 21 judges on that court where you appeal to, I think she said 16 have rejected Trump's appeals so far. So he keeps throwing, it's the equivalent of spaghetti at the wall, appealing that case in New York, and he keeps failing with everybody. And so he's going out there and saying it's unreasonable. Yet every judge in New York so far is like, no, it's totally reasonable. This is New York law.
Right.
Sorry, bud.
Okay. So, well, this is one listener, Sam. I can't find the whole thing, but he sent, where is that? You know what? I'm just going to bring it over here. Do it the low tech way. I'm going to cover you up. So, Trump alert. Hold on. Oh man. There we go. Breaking, Trump alert. Here it is. On Monday, Trump alert friend. On Monday, my sham trial in New York begins. They want me in prison. And he basically is exhorting them to, take to the streets and create chaos. This is what he wants. He doesn't want law and order, despite what he says. I mean, it's opposite world is what he does. Just be ready.
And we get those emails, right? Because somebody gave him our email. Like, most of the people who get those emails are people who've donated. And they're probably, if you... Nicole, you just confessed that you haven't actually donated to Donald Trump, because if you had, they could say, Nicole Sandler, they want to put me in prison.
That's right.
But my emails from Donald Trump also come addressed to friend. Friend, I may make you my vice president.
Ay, ay, ay. Lucky us. Now, one of my favorite stories that was just posted this morning to emptywheel.net, Walt Nauta claimed Trump hoarded hairspray cans in his storage rooms. That's not a surprise. I mean, we didn't know that before, but I guess that's something you would hoard.
So what that comes from is they released the transcript from Nauta's May 2022 interview with the FBI. And this interview, you have to know, this interview, I think it was May 26th, I'm working from memory, but Before and after the date of this interview, Nata has been helping Trump orchestrate this obstruction, like moving boxes in and out of Trump's suite so that Trump can kind of collate what he wants to make sure that Evan Corcoran doesn't give back. So it's happening right at that moment. That's when the FBI interviews him. And Nata, first of all, made it very clear he thinks he's very special because he used to fry eggs, he said, and now, you know, he works for a former president. So he's very happy about the prestige that comes from sucking up to Donald Trump. And when asked about what was stored, I mean, the FBI at one point in that interview, they're sort of like, you're lying to us. Like, what's in the storage room? I mean, at the very end of the interview, they're like, we need to know where those boxes came from, and we need to know where the rest of them are. And Nata, to that question, this is at the very end of the interview, he's like, hey, let's talk about the embassy in Madrid, you know, changing the subject. Earlier, they're like, what's in the storage room? And he's like, oh, hairspray. And then he says, and also golf shoes. And they're like, well, the golf shoes wouldn't be in bankers' boxes, would they? Like, he was obviously telling them a bullshit story. And one of the things I found most interesting about the interview was they kept asking him, does Trump know you're here? And Nata's like, oh, no, I told him Trump thinks I'm running, right? And the FBI clearly didn't believe that. The FBI was like, yeah, you know, is it bad that you lied to Trump about you being interviewed by the FBI right now? And he's like, no, I don't have to go actually run, you know? So I think they didn't believe that either. They just couldn't prove it as well as the charge. Some of the charges against him are that he deliberately lied to hide the fact that even as the FBI was investigating, Trump was sorting through boxes to decide what he was going to steal.
And this Walt Nata guy, it's still to this day now his body man. So he was in at Mar A Lago during this whole thing when the National Archives were trying to get these documents back. He was facilitating their transfer, in some cases, from Mar A Lago up to Bedminster, because we saw them being loaded onto a plane, right? I mean, he's complicit in this, and he's charged in it. Trump was paying for his attorney. Is he still?
He is. Yep. Yeah. His attorney, his main attorney, is a guy by the name of Stan Woodward, who also represented Peter Navarro, also represented one of the top oath keepers, also represented the guy who kicked off the entire insurrection on January 6th. The guy, he had a baseball cap on, a red baseball cap, and he comes up and he kind of gives Joe Biggs a big hug and then just starts going after cops. So that Stan Woodward has been one of the key players in Trump's sort of like, let's keep everyone on my side defense.
There's an order, right? Isn't there that Trump and Nata and the other guy who was the IT guy at Mar-a-Lago, they're not supposed to talk about the case at all because they're both co-defendants, right? But he's still working for him. He's his
partner. The other guy is not the IT guy. The IT guy is a cooperating witness. Oh. He had originally said something that wasn't true about trying to delete those videos.
Right.
That guy has come forward. There was a CNN interview with Caitlin Collins like 3 or 4 weeks ago that I think his last name is Butler. Okay. Worth seeing. He used the third co-defendant is Carlos de Oliveira, and so he was the maintenance guy.
Oh, the maintenance guy.
So those three are not supposed to talk about the trial. They're not supposed to talk about the case. But you know, Nata's with Trump all the time, every day. So.
Right. And so, if you think they're not talking about it, I've got some. I used to be able to say swampland not too far from here. Now, desert. I've got some desert not too far from here. I can sell you cheap because it's getting hot. I don't know where we go with this, but the fact that he admitted, and I don't think Trump will be happy about it. He said, yes, he is quite the hoarder with these particular items. Talked about the hairspray, and he said deodorant. So.
Right. So Nata's alibi for Donald Trump is it's not that he had stolen classified documents in that storage room. It's that he had hygiene products in that, you know, like shelves and shelves of hairspray and deodorant in that room rather than stolen documents. Right. So
sure.
Whatever.
Okay. All right. So that's where we are on all the Trump stuff. Action begins Monday. Be prepared for whatever. Now we've got to go to Hunter Biden's latest and Judge Mark Scarcy. And what do we need to know about what's going on here?
Oh, Mark Scarcy, and I said this last week, Mark Scarcy denied all of Hunter Biden's motions to dismiss. It took me a little while to get a transcript from the motions hearing. And, you know, the prosecutors in that case, I call it prosecutorial dickishness. You know, as a prosecutor, you can choose to be hyper-ethical or you can choose to get away with all the tricks that precedent says you can get away with. And the prosecutors against Hunter Biden are the latter case. Like they, just as an example, in that hearing, which was back in March, the prosecutor, among other things, said, I didn't have to go to Joseph Ziegler and Gary Shapley to find out, you know, that Hunter Biden was soliciting sex workers because it's in his memoir. And it's like, no, it's actually not in his memoir. Like his memoir is about drug addiction. It's not about sleeping with all these women. I mean, I have no reason to doubt that he did sleep with all these women. Where you know about him sleeping with all these women is from Rudy Giuliani releasing the hard drive. And it's from these IRS agents. So which of those is where you learned about the sex workers? Because it wasn't from the book. And so they keep saying they learned stuff from the book or that the fact that the book was there made it so much easier to prosecute. And it's like, so far you've made two mistakes about the book and you've invented the fact that Roger Stone doesn't have his own book. It's like, how many more mistakes are you going to have about the memoir, which according to you is the reason you charge this guy? It's just, I mean, you know, people in Maryland keep telling me that they think Leo Weiss, who's he's very experienced. He's worked on very high profile cases. He worked on Joseph Nocchio, the former CEO of Quest. He worked on Enron. So he's worked on very high profile public, but he's done some stuff recently where everyone in Baltimore is like, this stuff is crazy. He's gone after lawyers. He is shameless, really. I mean, he is shameless in the degree to which he's willing to bulldoze his way through things. And he's, you know, it's legal. There are precedents that allow prosecutors to do it. I just haven't seen this degree of it. I mean, I saw a bit of it in the John Durham case. Like one of his prosecutors did that kind of stuff. Did that kind of stuff pretty routinely. But I just, you know, you don't see that from Jack Smith, actually. You didn't see that. Like, I remember, I mean, I've talked to Scooter Libby's attorneys, and they're like, no. I mean, Pat Fitzgerald, who prosecuted Scooter Libby, right? One of the most ethical people. You don't see, like, Mueller could have done that, didn't do that. And so, you know, I just, it's sort of, you know, or for example, one of the reasons why we're having so much problems in the Aileen Cannon case is that Jack Smith, he didn't have to, but Jack Smith from the very beginning gave Trump not just the transcripts of witnesses who will testify, but gave him all of the grand jury transcripts.
Right.
And so Trump is trying to make some of that public. In the Hunter Biden case, he hasn't gotten those transcripts. And the prosecutors are like, we don't have to give you what's called gems. Like, if we don't have to tell you what witnesses are going to testify and what things they wrote about testimony that are sort of embarrassing or that you can use to discredit them. So their prosecutors aren't going to do that until 10 days before the Hunter Biden trial. That's fair. That's legal. That is, you know, permitted, but it's dickish, right?
Right.
So it's dickish. It's just like on a case of this magnitude, prosecutors don't do that. They didn't do that. John Durham didn't do that. Jack Smith isn't doing that. Robert Mueller didn't do that. And so, you know, the Hunter Biden prosecutors are doing that. And, you know, again, it's legal. They're allowed to do that. It's just dickish. It's just like, it's just this notion that the case is so fragile that if they do the norm that you would do in this high profile of a case, the whole thing will shrivel up and die. I mean, that's my theory. There's so much that they're trying to stave off. I mean, just as an example, in that same hearing, Leo Weiss said, you know, there's no proof that the IRS agents had a role in this case. I'm like, there's no officially released proof, but there is proof, right? So the FBI supervisor on that case, in his testimony to Jim Jordan, said, David Weiss, now special counsel, David Weiss and I had a conversation after Gary Shapley went to the press. And we had a conversation because we knew it was going to affect the case. There's your proof, right? Mm-hmm. And Jim Jordan was like, did it affect the case because he was telling the truth? And the FBI supervisor was like, no, it affected the case because the investigators started getting stopped. We started worrying about our family. We started worrying about the safety of the people on the team. And we know that the same thing happened with David Weiss. David Weiss testified to Jim Jordan that he was afraid for the safety of his family. So those two things by themselves would get you to the evidence. They're just not publicly released. And so, you know, Leo Weiss gets up there and, oh, there's no proof. I'm like, there is proof, but you're sitting on it. There is proof, but you're withholding it from Hunter Biden. And so there's a bunch of stuff like that where Leo Weiss is not going to give it to Hunter Biden when Jack Smith would have given it to Donald Trump.
Right.
And if he gave it, then you'd have proof that the IRS agents led David Weiss to renege on the plea deal. And that's why we're going forward with six felonies and six misdemeanors or whatever it is. So it's just, it's tasteless. It's legal, but it's tasteless. It's disgusting.
It is. Disgusting is a perfect word for it. The whole thing, the way they're targeting this guy. I mean, I truly feel for Hunter Biden. You know, everything he's gone through and had the plea deal and it was ready to, you know, he paid his taxes. He made restitution and now they're just going after him out of vengeance, it seems. And it's,
well, I don't know that it's vengeance. I just think that, you know, we don't know how Leslie Wolf, who was the prosecutor on the case, who negotiated that plea deal. We don't know precisely the terms of why she was removed and Leo Weiss and this guy, Derek Hines, replaced her. But in the process, Leo Weiss made claims in that plea colloquy. The judge, Judge Mary Ellen Noreika, said, you know, can you charge Hunter Biden with FARA? And Leo Weiss said, yeah, sure, we can. That's not the terms of the plea deal. That was the moment when David Weiss reneged on the plea deal. And David Weiss should have, he was sitting there in the back of the courtroom and he should have stood up and said, no, that's not the terms of the plea deal. The plea deal that I approved back on June 7th said there was no ongoing investigation. And now we know what the ongoing investigation is. It's Alexander Smirnoff. And so basically they brought Leo Weiss in, who's, you know, got 20 years of prosecutorial dickishness inside DOJ, very talented prosecutorial dickishness prosecutor. And they brought him in and, you know, I guess maybe David Weiss said, you can go after whatever you want to. If you take this job to replace Leslie Wolf, you can chase anything you want to. I don't know. This is my hypothesis. And then when the FD 1023, the Alexander Smirnoff false claims came back, Leo Weiss said, yeah, I'm going to go get Joe Biden. I want to run for political office. I mean, again, this is Maryland people speculating, but I'm going to, you know, take down Joe Biden. And so, and this guy, by the way, and this is something that kind of really concerns me. This guy is very close to Rod Rosenstein. Leo Weiss's
name from the past.
And Rod Rosenstein has said wonderful things about him. Very close to Rod Rosenstein.
Mm-hmm.
And then Gary Shapley had also very nice things to say about Rod Rosenstein. So you basically got this Baltimore mafia going after the Biden family and doing things that other special counsels don't do. I mean, again, legal, just sleazy.
Right.
And that's how they are conducting this investigation of the president's son. And just sloppy. Just sloppy. Like, don't, I mean, you know, they're right. We've got the claiming sawdust as cocaine. That's sort of the peak stupidity of that case. But like, one of the things that bothers me even more is they cited the memoir saying this is proof that he was addicted in 2018 when he bought a gun. And the citation they rely on is about something that happened in February 2019 after he got ketamine treatment from, we get to talk about Keith Ablo.
Keith Ablo, yes.
And in the memoir, Hunter Biden's like, the ketamine treatment maybe works. Like I had a relapse of my addiction because of the ketamine treatment. And so, but prosecutors miscite the data, don't say when it is, and haven't corrected it. And that's the kind of thing, like if you make a claim that says we prosecuted Hunter Biden because the memoir makes it so easy, and then you make fairly major error about what the memoir says. And oh, by the way, I also say Roger Stone didn't write a memoir, which of course he did. You know, you should correct that. As an ethical prosecutor, you should correct that. And they haven't done that. They've just, you know, like, they don't care. They're just going to keep going.
You know, this cabal, sort of, it reminds me of what they accuse the deep state. Yeah, these are people who are entrenched in the system, who have their own biases. But I guess the Republicans feel, and Trump world feels, it's the deep state and they're evil only if they're not supporters of their agenda. If they're Democrats, if they're, you know, if they support President Biden, then it's the deep state. If they work for Donald Trump, what, they're patriots?
Right. I mean, you know, Jim Jordan has changed the meaning of whistleblower. I mean, I think WikiLeaks did this to some degree, but Jim Jordan has invited any far right FBI agent who has been prohibited from politicizing FBI to come to him and complain and turn into a Fox News celebrity. Yeah. And, you know, that kind of stuff needs more attention, I think. I mean, even like the Hunter Biden stuff, yes. Again, like this is legal, but sleazy. And I just wish other journalists were calling him out, because so long as it's just me, you know, Leo Weiss, I'm sure if these Maryland people are right that he wants to run for political office, he's probably saying, you know, Marcy Wheeler isn't going to ruin my opportunity to run for attorney general or whatever in Maryland. But when special counsels are appointed, generally they have held, I mean, John Durham, one of John Durham's prosecutors clearly did not hold himself to a higher standard. And I just think, David Weiss's current prosecutors are doing a lot of things that are quite normal. I mean, I'm not saying this happens right all the time. I just, you know, normally when you're doing something of this profile, you don't rely on prosecutorial diggishness to the degree that these guys have.
Right. And that's their MO. Marcy Wheeler, we're about at the end of the hour, as always. These hours with you are just so valuable. I get so much from it. I know the listeners do too, and they appreciate it. I just want to end with a bit of kudos from the comments section on the piece, your piece at emptywheel.net about making CIPA history. Somebody with a screen name of Tech Support wrote, "Congrats, Marcy. I think it's easy these days to forget the true value of a free press in a functioning democracy, but it's never more apparent than in those moments when the work of journalists and the work of the courts intersect. Thank you." You're doing such important work, and if not for emptywheel.net and a very few other rare outlets, we wouldn't be getting this. So it's my time to ask you, just support her work, because it is so important. Emptywheel.net, lots of ways to support Marcy's journalism. She, like my show, is not behind a paywall, is not taking corporate advertising. We depend on your support to keep this going, and it's never been more important than it is now. So thank you, Marcy.
And support Nicole, too, because she invites me on every Friday, even though I have a potty mouth.
As do I, so it's fine. So you're not home right now. Are you in Dublin? Where are you?
I am in Westport, which is on the west coast of Ireland. It is a beautiful town, Croagh-Patrick, if people have heard about it. Kind of Ireland's holy mountain, but my brother and I rented some bikes and rode up to Achill Island, so it's beautiful, Ireland. It's just so, that's why I apologize for the quality of the video today, because I'm working on less than perfect Wi-Fi.
Yes, so and Wi-Fi is always a challenge anyway, but we got it, and I'll edit the few times we froze up during the hour. It's the only thing I edit, by the way, in case anybody wonders. We talk. And we just go for an hour, and usually it goes, just as we recorded it, unless there are technical problems, and you know I'm infected with gremlins here. So this time it's your Wi-Fi, but it's usually my Cox internet. But yeah, that's the only editing that we do. And please, if I get something wrong, do correct me, because I hate getting shit wrong, but it, you know, it happens every now and then. Marcy Wheeler, enjoy the rest of your time. Is the weather great there now? Is this like the good time of year?
No, it's Irish weather. So when we rode to Ochle Island, it was reasonably nice for the first 2 hours. And then as we got closer to the island, it just turned into like blustery, wet stuff on your face and really strong winds. I mean, the winds, you're right on the ocean, so the winds are quite strong here. So,
well, enjoy as much as, just so you know, yesterday after the show, went with my husband and my bonus son up to the Desert Botanical Gardens. It's the mega bloom, and it, you know, it's not what you would expect, but the cactuses all flower and they're gorgeous. Oh my God.
Beautiful time of the year in Arizona. It's
really nice. We have, I guess, about 2 weeks before it gets unbearably hot.
It's really hot.
Yeah, but it's
okay. Stay safe. Stay well.
You too. I'll talk to you next week. Thank you. And here we go. And here we go. Monday, it all begins. And we will cover it again with Marcy Wheeler on Friday as usual, but we'll be on it all week. We're on every day, Monday through Friday, live at 5 Eastern, 2 Pacific, 2 here in Arizona right now. All right, with that, have a great weekend, everyone. Turn off the news. Turn on the music. Get creative. Have fun. And we'll get back to it on Monday. That won't be fun. But we'll be here anyway. All right. Thanks for listening. Peace out.